Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of The Betrayal by Beverly Lewis, narrated by Christina Moore. Recorded Books Inspirational is an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. This book is copyrighted 2003 by Beverly Lewis. This recording is copyrighted 2004 by Recorded Books. In The Covenant, the first book of Beverly Lewis's Abram's Daughters series, Sadie was resistant to the plain life and its tragic consequences. Now, in The Betrayal, the journey continues with Leah and her beloved Jonas separated by hundreds of miles. But more than time and distance are conspiring to keep them apart. And now, The Betrayal.
August 9th, 1947. Dear Jonas, honestly, you spoil me. I've saved up a whole handful of your letters, and only a few months have passed since you left for Ohio. It's all I can do to keep from running to the kitchen calendar yet again to count up the days till your visit for our baptism Sunday next month. How good of your bishop to permit you to join my church district. The Lord above is working all things out for us, ain't so? Your latest letter arrived today in the mail, and I hurried out to the front porch and curled up in Mama's wicker chair to read in private. I felt you were right there with me, Jonas. Just the two of us together again. It's easy to see the many things you describe in Millersburg. The clabbered carpenter's shed, where you're busy with the apprenticeship. The big brick house where you eat and sleep. Even the bright faces of the little Mellinger children. How wonderful good the Lord God has been to give you your heart's ambition, and I am truly happy for you, and for us. Here in Gobbler's Knob, where you are sorely missed, there isn't much news, except to say I know of four new babies in a short radius of miles. Even our English neighbors down the road have a new little one. Soon we're all going to Grasshopper Level to lay eyes on your twin baby sister and brother. I have to admit, I don't know which I like better. Feeding chickens and threshing grain, or bathing and playing with my sweet baby sister, almost 3 months old. Lydian is so cuddly and cute, cooing and smiling at us. Dot laughs, saying I'm still his right-hand man. Let Mama and your sisters look after our wee one, he goes on. But surely he must know I won't be called Abram's Leah for too many more months now, though I haven't breathed a word. Still, I'm awful sure Mama and Aunt Lizzie suspect we're a couple. Dot, too, if he'd but accept the truth of our love. Come autumn, the people will no longer think of me as my father's replacement for a son. For that, I'm truly happy. Oh, Jonas, are there other couples like us? In another village or town, hundreds of miles from here, or just across the cornfield, are there two such close friends who also happen to be this much in love? Honestly, I can't imagine it. I miss you, Jonas. You seem so far away. Leah held the letter in her hands, reading what she'd written thus far. Truly, she hesitated to share the one thing that hung most heavily in her mind. Yet Jonas wrote about everything under the sun in his letters, so why shouldn't she feel free to do the same? She didn't want to speak out of turn, though. Should I tell Jonas about the unexpected visit yesterday from his father? She pondered. Truth was, Peter Mast had come rumbling into the barnyard in his market wagon like a house on fire. In short order, he and Dot had gone off to the high meadow for over an hour. Sure did seem awful strange. But when she asked Mama about it, she was told not to worry her little head. What on earth? She wondered. What business does Cousin Peter have with Dot? Part 1. The Daisy, by the shadow that it casts, protects the lingering dewdrop from the sun. William Wordsworth. Never praise a sister to a sister in the hope of your compliments reaching the proper ears. Rudyard Kipling. Chapter 1. Dog Days. The residents of Gobbler's Knob had been complaining all summer about the sweltering, brooding sun. Its intensity reduced clear and babbling brooks to a muddy trickle, turning broccoli patches into yellow flower gardens. Meadowlarks scowled at the parched earth void of worms, while variegated red and white petunias dropped their ruffled petticoats, waiting for a summertime shower. Worse still, evening hours gave only temporary pause, as did the dead of night if a faint breeze found its way through open farmhouse windows, bringing momentary relief to restless sleepers. Afternoons were nearly unbearable, and had been now for weeks, June 12th having hit the record high at 97 degrees. Abram and Ida Ebersol's farmhouse stood at the edge of a great woods as a shelter against the withering heat. The grazing and farmland surrounding the house had a warm and genial scent, heightened by the high temperatures. Abram's 7 acres and the neighboring farmland were an enticing sanctuary for a variety of God's smaller creatures, squirrels, birds, chipmunks, and field mice, the latter a good enough reason to tolerate a dozen barn cats. Not far from the barnyard, hummocks of coarse, panicled grass bordered the mule road near the outhouse, and a well-worn path cut through a high green meadow leading to the log house of Ida's maidel sister, Lizzie Brenneman. Ida, midlife mother to nearly 3-month-old Lydianne, along with 4 teenage girls, Sadie, Leah, and twins Hannah and Mary Ruth, found a welcome reprieve this day in the dampness of the cold cellar beneath the large upstairs kitchen, where Sadie and Hannah were busy sweeping the cement floor, redding up in general. Abram had sent Leah indoors along about 3:30 for a break from the beastly heat. Ida was glad to have plenty of help wiping down the wooden shelves, making ready for a year's worth of canned goods, 800 quarts of fruits and vegetables, once the growing season was past. Working together, they lined up dozens of quarts of strawberry preserves and about the same of green beans and peas, 17 quarts of peaches thus far, and 36 quarts of pickles, sweet and dill. Some of the recent canning had been done with Aunt Lizzie's help, as well as that of their close neighbors, the Smithy's wife, Miriam Peachy, and daughters, Ada and Dorcas. The Ebersol girls took their time organizing the jars, not at all eager to head upstairs before long and make supper in the sultry kitchen. "I dare say this is the hottest summer we've had in years," Mama remarked. "And not only here," Leah added, "the heat hasn't let up in Ohio neither." Mary Ruth mopped her fair brow. "Your beau must be keeping you well informed of the weather in Millersburg, yeah?" To this, Hannah grinned. "We could set the clock by Jonas's letters, ain't so, Leah?" Leah, 17 in 2 months, couldn't help but smile, and much too broadly at that. Dear, dear Jonas, what a wonderful good letter writer he was, sending word nearly 3 times a week or so. This had surprised her, really. But Mama always said it was most important for the young man to do the wooing, either by letters or in person. So Jonas was well thought of, in Mama's eyes at least. Not so much Dot's. No, her father held fast to his enduring hope of Leah's marrying the blacksmith's 20-year-old son, Gideon Peachy, nicknamed Smithy Gid, next farm over. Sadie stepped back as if to survey her neat row of quart-sized tomato soup jars. "Writing to Cousin Jonas about the weather can't be all that interesting now, can it?" she said, eyeing Leah. "We write about lots of things," Leah tried to explain, sensing one of Sadie's moods. "Why do you have to go all the way out to Ohio for his apprenticeship anyway?" Sadie asked. Mama looked up just then, her earnest blue eyes intent on her eldest. "Aw, Sadie, you know the reason," she said.
Sadie's apologetic smile looked forced, and she turned back to her work. The subject of Jonas and his letters was dropped. Mama's swift reprimand was followed by silence, and then Leah gave a long, audible sigh. Yet Leah felt no animosity, but with Sadie seemingly miserable all the time. Sadie was never-ending blue and seemed as shriveled in her soul as the ground was parched. If only the practice of Rumspringa, the carefree, sometimes wild years before baptism, had been abolished by Bishop Bontrager years ago. A group of angry parents had wished to force his hand to call an end to the foolishness, but to no avail. Unchecked, Sadie had allowed a fancy English boy to steal her virtue. Poor dear Sadie. If she could, Leah would cradle her sister's splintered soul and hand it over to the mender of broken hearts, the Lord Jesus. She offered a silent prayer for her sister and continued to work side by side with Mama. Soon she found herself daydreaming about her wedding, thinking ahead to which sisters she might ask to be in her bridal party and whom she and Mama would ask to be their kitchen helpers. Selecting the hostlers, the young men who would oversee the parking of buggies and the care of the horses, was the groom's decision. Jonas had written that he wanted to talk over plans for their wedding day when he returned for baptism. He also wanted to spend a good part of that weekend with her and her alone. But on the following Monday, he must return to Ohio to complete his carpentry apprenticeship, just till apple-picking time. His father's orchard was too enormous not to have Jonas's help come October. And then it wouldn't be long after the harvest and they'd be married. Leah knew their wedding would fall on either a Tuesday or Thursday in November or early December, the official wedding season in Lancaster County. She and Mama would be deciding fairly soon on the actual date, though since Jonas didn't know precisely when he'd be returning home for good, she had to wait to discuss it with him. Secretly, she hoped he would agree to choose an earlier rather than a later date. As for missing Jonas, the past months had been nearly unbearable. She drank in his letters and answered them quickly, doing the proper thing and waiting till he wrote to her each time. It was painful for her, knowing she'd rejected his idea to spend the summer in close proximity to him out in Holmes County, a way to avoid the dreaded long-distance courtship. But for Sadie's sake, Leah had stayed put in Gobbler's Knob, wanting to offer consolation after the birth and death of her sister's premature baby. In all truth, she had believed Sadie needed her more than Jonas. But Jonas had been disappointed, and she knew it by the unmistakable sadness in his usually shining eyes. She had told him her mother needed help with a new baby, the main excuse she'd given. Dismayed, he pressed her repeatedly to reconsider. The hardest part was not being able to share her real reason with him. Had Jonas known the truth, he would have been soundly stunned. At least he might have understood why she felt she ought to stay behind, which had nothing to do with being too shy to live and work in a strange town, as she assumed he might think. Most of all, she hoped he hadn't mistakenly believed her father had talked her out of going. Today, Leah was most eager to continue writing her letter the minute she completed chores, hoping to slip away again to her bedroom for a bit of privacy. When she considered how awful hot the upstairs had been these days, she thought she might take herself off to the coolness of the woods, stationery and pen in hand. If not today, then tomorrow for sure. No one knew it, but here lately she'd been writing to Jonas in the forest. Before her beau had left town, she would never have thought of venturing into the deepest part, only going as far as Aunt Lizzie's house. But she liked being alone with the trees, her pen on the paper, the soft breezes whispering her name, and Jonas's. Growing up, she'd heard the tales of folk becoming disoriented in the leafy maze of undergrowth and the dark burrow of trees. Still, she was determined to go, delighting in being surrounded by all of nature. There, a place of solitude awaited her, away from her sister's prying eyes, as well as a place to dream of Jonas. She had sometimes wondered where Sadie and her worldly beau had run off to many times last year, before Sadie sadly found herself with child. But when Leah searched the woods, she encountered only tangled brushwood and nearly impassable areas where black tree roots and thick shrubbery caused her bare feet to stumble. Both she and Sadie had not forgotten what it felt like as little girls to scamper up to Aunt Lizzie's for a playful picnic in her secluded backyard. Thanks to her, they were shown dazzling violets amid sward and stone, demanding attention by the mere look on their floral faces, and were given a friendly peep into a robin's comfy nest. "But not too close," Aunt Lizzie would whisper. All this and more during such daytime adventures. But never had Lizzie recommended the girls explore the expansive woods on their own. In fact, she turned ashen on at least one occasion when 7-year-old Leah wondered aloud concerning the things so oft repeated. "Ach, you mustn't think of wandering in there alone," Lizzie had replied quickly. Sadie, at the innocent age of 9, had trembled a bit, Leah recalled, her older sister's blue eyes turning a peculiar grayish green. And later, Leah had vowed to Sadie she was content never to find out what awful, frightening things are hiding in them there wicked woods. Now Leah sometimes wondered if maybe Sadie truly had believed the scary tales and taken them to heart, she might not have ended up the ruined young woman she was. At the tender age of 19. At the evening meal, Dot sat at the head of the long kitchen table, with doting Mama to his left. 14-year-old Hannah noticed his brown hair was beginning to gray, bangs cropped straight across his forehead and rounded in a bowl shape around the ears and neck. He wore black work pants, a short-sleeved green shirt, and black suspenders, though his summer straw hat likely hung on a wooden peg in the screened-in porch. Before eating, they all bowed heads simultaneously as the memorized prayer was silently given by each Ebersol family member, except baby Lydia Ann, who was nestled in Mama's pleasingly ample arms. O Lord God, Heavenly Father, bless us and these thy gifts, which we shall accept from thy tender goodness and grace. Give us food and drink also for our souls unto life eternal, and make us partakers of thy heavenly table through Jesus Christ, thy Son. Amen. Following the supper blessing, they silently prayed the Lord's Prayer. Meanwhile, Hannah tried to imagine how the arranged seating pattern might look once Leah was married. She worried her twin also might not remain under Dot's roof much longer, not if she stayed true to her hope of higher education. How Mary Ruth would pull off such a thing, Hannah didn't know, especially now with Elias Stoltzfus making eyes at her. She gazed at her sisters just now, from youngest to eldest. The table would look mighty bare with only 5 of them present, counting Dot, Mama, and Baby, Sadie, and herself. It wouldn't be long till Lydia Ann could sit in a high chair scooted up close. That would help round things out a bit. That and if Mama were to have another baby or two. Anything was possible, she assumed, since Mama was approaching 43, not too terribly old for childbearing, because on the Brenneman side of the family, there are plenty of women in the family way clear into their late 40s, some even into the early 50s. So who is to say just how many more Ebersol children the Lord God might see fit to send along? Honestly, she wouldn't mind if there were a few more little sisters or brothers. And Mary Ruth would be delighted, too. Her twin was ever so fond of wee ones and all. This made Hannah wonder how many children young and handsome Ezra Stoltzfus might want to have with his wife someday. She could only hope that, at nearly 16, he might find her as fetching as she thought he was. Here lately, she was mighty sure he had taken more of a shine to her, which was right fine. Of course, now he'd have to be the one to pursue her once she turned courting age. She wouldn't be flirting her way into a boy's heart like some girls. Besides, she wasn't interested in attracting a beau that way. She wanted a husband who appreciated her femininity, a man who would love her for herself, for who she was, not for attractiveness alone. Hours after supper, alone in their bedroom, Leah offered to brush Sadie's waist-length hair. I could make loose braids if you want, she said. Sadie nodded half-heartedly, seemingly preoccupied. Leah tried not to stare as Sadie settled down on a chair near the mirrored dresser, yet her sister looked strangely different. Sadie's flaxen locks tumbled down over her slender back and shoulders, and the glow from the single oil lamp atop the dresser cast an ivory hue on her normally pale cheeks, making them appear even more ashen, a shadow of herself. Standing behind Sadie, she brushed out the tangles from the long workday, then finger-combed through the silken hair, watching tenderly all the while in the mirror. Sadie's fragile throat and chin were silhouetted in the lamp's light, her downcast eyes giving her countenance an expression of pure grief. Truly, Leah wanted to spend time with Sadie tonight, though it meant postponing the rest of her letter to Jonas. Tomorrow she would finish writing her long letter to him, head up to the woods to share her heart on paper. She and Sadie had dressed for bed rather quickly, accompanied by their usual comments, speaking in quiet tones of the ordinary events of the day, of having especially enjoyed Mama's supper of barbecued chicken, scalloped potatoes with cheese sauce, fried cucumbers, lima beans, and lemon bars with homemade ice cream for dessert. But now this look of open despair on Sadie's face caused Leah to say softly, "I think about him, too." "Who?" Sadie whispered, turning to look up at her. "Your baby. My own little nephew gone to heaven." Leah's throat tightened at the memory. "You do, sister?" "Oh, ever so much." Neither of them spoke for a time. Then Leah said, "What must it be like for you, Sadie? Ugh, I can't imagine your grief." Sadie was lost in her own world again. She moaned softly, leaning her head back for a moment. "I would have let him sleep right here, you know, in a little cradle in this very room," she whispered. "I would have wanted to raise him like a little brother to all of us, you, Hannah and Mary Ruth, Lydia Ann, too." If Sadie's baby had lived, the disgrace on the Ebersol name would have been immense. But Sadie didn't need to be reminded of that at the moment. Gently finishing up with her sister's hair, Leah began brushing her own, letting it hang long and loose, down past her waist. But quickly Sadie reached for the brush and said, "Here, it's your turn, Leah. Let me." Later, after Sadie had put out the lamp, they continued to talk softly in bed, though now about Mama's plans to visit the Mast cousins soon. "I used to think it would be fun to have twins," Sadie said. "What about you?" "If I could simply play with them all day, maybe so. But to cook and clean and garden and everything else a mother must do, well, I just don't know how I'd manage." "Oh, Leah, you're too practical compared to me." Leah had to smile at that. "I guess we are different that way." After a lull in their conversation, Sadie brought up the snide remark she'd made earlier in the day. "Honestly, I didn't mean to taunt you about writing to Jonas," she said. "It was wrong of me." "'Tis not such a bad thing to write about the weather, yeah?" Sadie lay still next to her. "I'm thinking a girl ought to write whatever she pleases to a beau." Whatever she pleases. Inwardly, Leah sighed. Wasn't that Sadie's biggest problem? Doing whatever she pleased had nearly destroyed her young life. In the past, Leah and Sadie had been like two pole beans on a vine, growing up under the same roof together. "What's happened to us?" she wondered. Tender moments like tonight's were few and far between. Sadie rested her head on the feather pillow just so, being careful not to muss her pretty braids. Tomorrow her hair bun would be a fairly wavy one, something Mama wouldn't take too kindly to. Neither would Dot if he happened to notice. But Leah's fingers and the gentle brush on her hair had soothed her greatly. Sometimes it felt like old times, as if nothing had changed. A fond return to their friendlier days of sisterhood when they had shared every detail of each other's lives. Her chin trembled and tears sprang to her eyes. Leah had always been a true and compassionate sister, but even more dear this summer. Forfeiting her own desire to spend time with Jonas, Leah had stayed home to comfort her. Turning over, she fought hard to compose herself, lest she be heard sniffling again tonight. She did not pray her silent rote prayers. The desire to do so had long since left. She honestly believed the Lord God had seen fit to take away her tiny son instead of allowing her to love a baby conceived in sin, and the thought made her heart cold with aching. Yet nearly every night, in a dream, she was with her own wee babe, who was ever so alive. And she and Derry were still desperately in love, sometimes even married, and always completely taken with their new little one, holding him, cooing baby talk at him. Alas, upon waking each morning, Sadie was hit yet again with the ugly, hard truth. She had been punished for the sin of youthful lust. More than 100 times she had recalled that hideous night, how Dr. Henry Schwartz had kindly said he would take care of the baby's remains. Now she regretted there was not even a small burial plot under the shade of ancient trees. Not a simple, respectable grave marker had been given her child, no grassy spot to visit in the people's cemetery, where she could grieve openly beneath a wide blue sky, where she could lie down under a tree and let her body rest hard against the earth. Her precious son had come into the world much too early, with no breath in him, as the doctor had sadly pronounced. Sometimes, during the daylight hours, it almost seemed as if the birth itself had never occurred, though she lived with a gnawing emptiness that threatened to choke her. Not having a place to mark the date and the event made the memory of that dark April night oft-times shift in her mind, even distort itself. Sadie was back and forth about the whole thing. Some days she treasured the memory of her first love, at other times she despised Derry for what he'd done to her. Often she would stop what she was doing, painfully aware of a newborn's whimper. Was her imagination playing tricks? She would look around to see where her baby might be. Could Lydia Ann's frequent crying trigger this? She didn't know. Yet the alarming sense that her baby still lived persisted no matter where she went these days. To preaching service, to Ada and Dorcas Peachy's house, or to any number of Ebersol and Mast cousins' homes. The lingering feeling haunted her through every daylight hour, as acute as it was bewildering. In spite of her depression, Sadie tried to look to the future, hoping someday she might have another baby to love, one whose father loved her enough to marry her in the first place, one with no connection to the Gobbler's Knob grapevine and who had no inkling of her wild days. Yet to meet a nice, eligible Amish man like that, she would have to leave home, abandoning everything dear to her. It would mean enduring the shun. The only other choice she had was a kneeling repentance before the church brethren. But how could that ever solve her problems? It would never bring her baby back, nor Derry, neither one. Repenting could guarantee her only one thing, a lonely and miserable life. Chapter 2. Leah hadn't realized before just how vulnerable she felt walking through the tunnel of trees that comprised much of the hillock. Even in the full sun of late morning, the light filtering through the webbing of leaves and branches seemed to die away the farther she headed into the woods. Her best stationery folded neatly and pen in hand, she plodded onward, hoping to rediscover the same grassy spot where she'd spent a sun-dappled hour a few days ago. Beneath the feathery shade of a rare and beautiful thornless honey locust tree, she had written one of her love letters to Jonas. Never once did she think she'd have such difficulty finding the exact location a second time, so lovely it had been. Yet with hundreds of trees towering overhead, confusing her, how could she? At the moment she thought the sun had set prematurely over distant green hills, she came upon a most interesting sight. She stopped in her tracks and wriggled her toes in the mossy path.
"Well, what is this?" she whispered.
There, in a small clearing, a tiny shanty stood, though just barely. In all truth, it was leaning slightly to the left, and as she stepped back to take in the strange place, she could see it was quite old and in dire need of repair. Walking gingerly around its perimeter, she decided the wood shack was probably safe enough to enter. She did so, and quickly, too, because the wind had suddenly come up, blowing hard from the north with an edge to it. The sky was growing darker now, even as she pushed hard against the rickety door and hurried inside. Much to her surprise, she found a rather cozy, if untidy, room with exposed plank walls and overhead beams. Several wooden benches were scattered round, the only places to sit. A waist-high, makeshift counter stood in the back, along with a metal trash can. Still, nothing inside really hinted at what purpose the shack served. Placing her writing paper down on one of the benches, she stood in the center of the little room and curiously looked around. It was in need of a good redding up, as Mama would say. Both Mama and Lizzie required cleanliness in all things, and had they come with her today, they would have immediately set to work picking up the paper debris and whatnot littering the floor. Never mind that the shack wasn't part of someone's house or barn. It needed some tending to. Even Mama's potting shed was far neater. Going to stand at the window, she leaned on the ledge and looked out at the wind beginning to whip through the shrubbery, bending the trees something fierce. She decided she might as well stay put for the time being, what with the storm rustling things up so. Not that she would complain about a blustery rain shower, not since the good Lord had allowed this heat wave to encompass the region. Thirsty crops would drink up a downpour like this in short order. She was ever so glad for even this unsteady shelter. The rain intensified, hammering wildly on the ramshackle roof. Settling down on a bench, Leah picked up where she'd left off with her letter to Jonas, putting her pen to the cream-colored paper. "There's one thing I should tell you in case you hear it through the grapevine. I hope you won't feel bad about this. Here lately I've had to help my father outdoors more than ever since Dotty John's hip gave out a few days ago. It's a pity seeing Mama's father suffer. My sisters and I take our turns keeping him company, as does Aunt Lizzie. Sometimes to help Mama, I take him over to the village doctor, Henry Schwartz, who's as kind as he can be. As for working alongside Dot again, I've always known I was meant for the soil, called to it, really. And once you and I are married, Dot will simply have to hire some extra help. Soon I'll be tending my own vegetable and flower gardens and cooking and keeping house for you while you build oak tables and chairs in your carpenter shop nearby. We'll be happy as larks. By the way, there's a small house with a for rent sign in the front yard less than a mile from here, set back a ways from the road, even has an outbuilding on the property. Maybe Dot and I will go see about it if you agree we should. I'll send this off right quick, then wait eagerly for your next letter. All my love, your faithful Leah." She reread the letter, then folded the stationery. Leaning back, she stretched her arms and noticed a leak in the highest peak of the roof. Within seconds, the droplets turned to a trickle, then a near-steady silver stream intruded upon her refuge against the cloudburst. Not a bucket was in sight, only the trash can, overflowing with refuse. She searched for something else to catch the water, but was startled to hear running footsteps outdoors and rushed to the window to look. "What's Aunt Lizzie doing out in this?" she wondered. The door to the shanty flew open, and there stood Mama's younger sister, soaked clean through to the skin. Lizzie's face turned instantly pale upon seeing Leah.
"Well, I never—" "Hurry and come in out of the squall, Endy."
The brunette woman leaned hard against the door, shoving out the wind and rain.
"What on earth are you doing here?"
"Oh, I'd hoped to find a comfortable spot under a tree somewhere, before the rain was making down so suddenly." She glanced over at her letter. "Caught me by surprise, really." Lizzie nodded her head. Seems the woods have a climate all their own, ain't so? Leah knew how much her aunt, even at 35, enjoyed exploring the forest, truly Lizzie's own backyard. Drawn to small woodland creatures, Lizzie often amused Leah and her sisters with animal-related stories. Leah sometimes wondered how it could be that Aunt Lizzie seemed so at home in the very woods she'd always warned against, knowing the name of each tall and dark tree at first glance. Lizzie's heart was as tender as the petal blossoms she cherished, and she doted on her nieces beyond all reason. Outside, the rain was spilling fast over the eaves in elongated droplets, like the delicate oval pearls Leah had seen on the bare neck of a worldly Englishwoman in a Watt and Shands department store newspaper ad. But inside, the stream from the unseen hole in the roof had taken up a rhythm all its own, predictable and annoying. "Do you think you could help me find one particular tree if I described it? I mean, after the rain stops." Aunt Lizzie smiled, pulling on the soaked-through purple sleeve that clung to her arm. Her long black apron and prayer cap were also sopping wet. "Which tree's that, honey girl?" "One where the grass is soft and thick and grows right up to the trunk. I must admit to thinking of the forest floor beneath it as my piece of earth." She went on to tell about the curious honey locust tree. "It has no thorns. And if ever I could find it once more, I believe I might somehow mark it so I could return there again and again." "Oh, 'twas a wonderful good place to daydream, yeah?" "Not dream so much as write a newsy letter," she confessed. "My sisters are awful nosy sometimes. They'd just love to know what I'm writing to Jonas." "Well, so that's what brought you here." Lizzie seemed somehow relieved as she spoke. She went and sat down on the closest bench, and Leah did the same. "I never knew this place existed." "Well, I dare say it's about to come a-tumbling down, which, if you ask me, might be a good thing." "Oh, I don't know. Maybe with a little sweeping and picking up, it could be a right nice spot to—" "No. No." Aunt Lizzie shook her head, turning to face the side window. "Best leave it for the turkey shooters come Thanksgiving." With Lizzie's quick remark, Leah felt she understood. So, the lean-to had been built long ago to provide shelter for small game hunters, nothing more. "Since we're up here away from everyone," Leah said softly, "I can tell you I'm terribly worried about Sadie." Aunt Lizzie stared hard at the floor. "Yeah, I fret over her too. Must be something we can do." Aunt Lizzie nodded, removing her wet prayer bonnet. "I have to say I do miss her purty smile. And I think Mama does, too. A cheerful countenance comes from the joy of the Lord God rising up from one's heart." Leah wasn't surprised at this remark. Aunt Lizzie often spoke of the Holy One of Israel as if he were a close friend or relative. "What more can we do?" she asked. "Nothing short of hauling Sadie off to the preacher or the deacon, I suppose." Aunt Lizzie's face dropped with her own words. "'Tis awful frustrating. Honestly, I never would have promised to keep Mum if I'd thought Sadie would remain stubborn for this long." For a time, Lizzie was silent. "Your sister would never trust you again, and she might not forgive me neither." "We can't just let Sadie lose her way, can we, Aunt Lizzie?" "Indeed, seems to me something's got to break loose here for long. Either that or she'll make a run for it." Leah gasped. "Sadie would leave?" "I'm afraid it was my idea. Last year I'd suggested a visit to Ohio might do her good, but I fear now she might never return." Leah felt limp all over. She didn't know what to make of it. Sadie hadn't mentioned a word. Aunt Lizzie continued, "I pleaded with her to stay put until at least your wedding. Perhaps by then she'll come to her senses. I pray so." She rose and went to the window. "I've talked to her till my breath is nearly all. To no avail. Still, I won't stop beseeching the Lord God Heavenly Father for her. A stark silence followed, and Leah was mindful of the calm outside as well. The summer shower had passed. Chapter 3. The ground was soggy beneath their bare feet when Leah and Lizzie left the safety of the hunter's shack to hike down the hill toward home. Birds warbled a chorus of gladness, and the overcast sky steadily brightened as the sun finally succeeded in peeking out of the slow-moving gray clouds. Lizzie put her nose up and sniffed. "Does the air smell sweet to you after a shower?" Leah inhaled the clean, mint-like scent. "We could stand to have moisture like this every single day from now till Jonas and I..." Lizzie offered a gentle smile. "Well, go on, Leah, dear. I can keep quiet about your wedding plans. You can trust me with the day Jonas will take you as his bride." "Yeah, I would, but... well..." She sputtered a bit. Lizzie must have sensed the awkwardness and attempted to smooth things over promptly. "What do you expect we'll do about all that parched celery, honey girl? You and your mama will have a whole house full of folk to feed at the wedding feast, with no celery." Mama's celery stalks had been looking altogether pathetic, what with the intense heat and lack of precipitation, even with the additional hand-watering they'd been doing lately. Leah spoke up. "Maybe Fanny Mast's vegetable patch is faring better than ours." She could only hope that was true, although with infant twins, Mama's first cousin Fanny would be hard-pressed to keep her one-acre garden going without help from daughters Rebecca, 16, and Katie, 13, and occasionally 9-year-old Martha. Aunt Lizzie pushed ahead on the unmarked path, Leah following close behind, aware of the people's whispered tittle-tattles surrounding the wedding tradition of serving celery. Taking a long breath, she held it a moment before letting the air out. "Mama says it's, necessary for the young couple to eat plenty of celery at their wedding feast." "For the sake of fruitfulness," Aunt Lizzie replied over her shoulder. "The Lord God put every plant, vegetable, fruit, and herb, on the earth for a purpose. Some have healing properties, others aid in digestion, and, well, getting young couples off to a right good start, you know." And that was the closest thing to a lesson on the birds and bees she knew she'd be getting from either Aunt Lizzie or Mama. Of course, Sadie could easily fill her in to high heaven if she chose to, but Leah didn't care to ask. Not the way Sadie had gotten the cart long before the horse. Better to discover such things later, after Leah belonged to Jonas and he to her, in the sight of the Lord God. They had reached the place where something of a meandering dirt path appeared, descending into a grassy area with less underbrush to tangle one's bare feet. Lizzie's small house was in sight at last, up ahead on the left. This corner of God's green earth had a pungent fragrance, and its pleasantness made Leah suddenly think of Mama, and an early morning promise Leah had made. "Ach, I nearly forgot!" Lizzie turned quickly. "Forgot what?" "Mama's expecting me home." "Well then, mustn't keep her waiting." Leah glanced up at the sky. "We're going to bake up a batch of cherry pies. Then after a bit, Dot will be needing me at milking time. You'll have to come visit me again soon." Nodding, she said she would. "Or, better yet, why don't you come down tonight and have a piece of my pie? I'm determined for it to taste wonderful good." "You'll do just fine. And when your dessert turns out to be ever so delicious, we'll compare notes, yeah?" "Mama scarcely ever writes down recipes, you know. It's all up here." Leah tapped her head. "Your mama's one of the best cooks round here. She takes the cake now, don't she?" Lizzie said, a hint of sadness in her eyes. Sadie's unwillingness to repent seemed to tinge nearly everything. Leah hugged her, then broke free and headed on down the mule road toward home, turning briefly to wave to her dear aunt. But Lizzie was already gone. Ida had been standing at the open window upstairs, having put the baby down for an early afternoon nap. Grateful for the coolness after the rain, she stepped back to allow a breeze into the bedroom. She could clearly see Leah up there in the woods, waving a fond goodbye to Lizzie. Then, here she came, bounding almost deer-like out of the trees as her long skirt swept the damp ground. "What's my sister filling Leah's head with today?" she wondered, suspecting the pair had gone walking together, picking wild flowers, making a fuss over every little plant and animal. That was Lizzie's way, always had been. She was bent on soaking up every inch of the woodlands, introducing each of Ida's girls to the vast world of flora and fauna. Sadie had been spending all kinds of time up at Lizzie's during the past few months. Nearly all summer, really, until just the past week or so. More recently, Lizzie had singled Leah out. She supposed Lizzie had every right to spend her spare time with whomever she pleased, but it irked her to no end. Truly, she wished Lizzie might keep her nose out of Abrams and her family's business. Lizzie and Peter Mast both. They'd all lived this long just fine. Some things were best left unsaid. She exhaled sharply and headed downstairs, refusing to dwell on her fears for another minute. In the kitchen, she laid out the flour, sugar, and all the necessary ingredients for the mouth-watering pies. As she did, she thought ahead to the next preaching service to be held here this weekend. 200 and more church members would come from a 4-square-mile radius to gather where Abram's own father, the respected Bishop Ebersol, had raised this stone house as a shelter for his family and as a house of worship amongst the people. Hopefully, by then, Lizzie's urgency could be put to rest. Ida made a mental note to talk with Abram about it once again. Sadie, with a bucket of soapy water in hand, set about to wash down the bedroom walls, helping Mama cleanse the house, as was their custom, creating a holy place for the Sunday preaching. "Might as well get a head start on some heavy cleaning," she told Mama at the noon meal. "'Tis a good thing to make hay while the sun shines, too," Mama had said in passing, somewhat inattentive. Sadie was relieved to have the afternoon alone. Her twin sisters were downstairs, dusting, sweeping, washing floors and whatnot. These days it was best on her nerves to have absolute solitude, though that was next to impossible with 7 people in the house. She had been suffering such a peculiar dull ache up and down her forearms, confiding it only to Aunt Lizzie earlier this summer. What a surprise to discover Lizzie's remedy was to carry around a 5-pound sack of potatoes, much the size of a wee babe. Lo and behold, when she did so, Sadie found it truly eased her pain. Accordingly, she clasped the potatoes quite often, and ever so gently, while spending time at Lizzie's away from Mama's eyes. Aside from frequent walks up to Lizzie's place, Sadie preferred to spend her alone hours cleaning for Mama or hoeing and weeding the vegetable garden, along with visits next door to the Doughty house to chat with Doughty John. Today she wholeheartedly threw herself into her work, stepping back now and again to see if she'd covered every square inch of the light gray walls. The bedroom windows were next on her list of things to do. She'd already decided to wash them single-handedly. No need asking for help from Hannah and Mary Ruth, not when they had plenty to keep them occupied downstairs. As for Leah, she'd hurried out the back door and headed up toward the mule road, as if going to visit Aunt Lizzie. But Sadie was schmerder. It didn't take much effort to figure out Leah these days. All of them assumed she was going off to the woods to write to her beau, just so she kept her promise and didn't reveal Sadie's wild rumspringa to Jonas Mast. Both Leah and Lizzie had vowed to keep quiet, but Sadie had heard recently that her former sidekick, Naomi Kaufman, was said to be weary of flirting with the world. She was even taking baptismal instruction right along with Leah, preparing to join church, of all things. Sadie didn't appreciate Naomi setting herself up as holier than thou, which she certainly seemed to think she was here lately. And why? Just because she'd been far more careful than Sadie, or plain lucky, and hadn't gotten caught. Besides, Naomi's unexpected turn had more to do with Luke Bontrager, who was awful sweet on her, than most anything else. Of this, Sadie was fairly sure. If Naomi was to become the bride of the bishop's grandson, she had some fast confessing to do. Now, wasn't that a howdy-do? It was all fine and dandy for Naomi to make amends, turn her life around, and plan for a future as an upstanding young woman, so long as she kept Sadie out of it. Hopefully, Naomi didn't know the half about Sadie's fling, but what did she know? And if she started spilling the beans, what then? After all, Naomi had continued to see Derry's friend Melvin Warner after that first meeting at the Strasbourg Café. Derry had told Sadie this on several occasions, and she assumed it was true. When Sadie was finished with the three upstairs bedrooms, she moved to the hallway and commenced to do the same, washing down walls, scrubbing mop boards, and mashing a few stray spiders as she went. Her thoughts flew to Aunt Lizzie as she worked. The past few weeks, Sadie had been discouraged. Not only had her aunt changed her mind and become adamant about her staying put, Lizzie was now saying she didn't think Sadie needed a change of scenery after all. "Don't you see," Lizzie had insisted, "your father's covering and blessing are mighty important. If you would but confess to preacher and the membership, you'd be pardoned by the people." Aunt Lizzie went on to quote her favorite scripture. "Godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, but the sorrow of the world worketh death." Obliged to listen, Sadie felt hot under the bonnet when Aunt Lizzie talked so pointedly. Chapter 4. Too warm to stay indoors a second longer, Mary Ruth stepped outside for a breather on the back stoop. King, the German shepherd puppy, came scampering across the yard to greet Leah. Her skirt was mud-spattered as she stooped to pet the dog, a curious yet kindly gift from Gid Peachy last spring. Observing this, Mary Ruth smiled as Leah hurried toward the house, the dog panting as he followed close on her heels. "Hello, Mary Ruth. I missed you," Leah said. Mary Ruth hoped Leah wouldn't go running off to help Dot, not when she had a question to ask. "Did you get caught in the rain?" Leah's face reddened. "No, I found shelter." Sighing, Mary Ruth decided not to beat round the bush. "Does it bother you that Dot doesn't approve of you marrying Jonas?" Leah seemed a bit startled by the question, but she met Mary Ruth's gaze with a gentle smile. "Does it bother you?" Pausing there, Mary Ruth was aware of Leah's sweetness once again, her fine hazel eyes with tiny gold flecks, the dark curve of her long lashes, the way her expression seemed to radiate trustfulness, even goodness. Yet Leah was intent on ignoring Dot's wishes in order to become Jonas Mast's bride. None of it added up. "Doesn't bother me in the least," she replied at last. "I'm just trying to understand." Leah burst into a full smile. "That's what makes you so special. You have a gift of understanding, I dare say." Mary Ruth couldn't help herself. She actually choked a little and tears welled up. "Much good that does me." Leah was staring now, wearing a concerned frown. "What is it, Mary Ruth? Why are you crying?" "Just thinking, I guess." She forged ahead and stuck her neck out. "I hope you'll follow your heart. Have the courage to marry the boy you love." Leah's eyelids fluttered. "Did you think I might not?" Turning quickly, Mary Ruth looked over her shoulder toward the barn. "Dot, well, he's made it mighty clear here lately that it's Gideon Peachy who's the right beau for you. He's said as much to all of us."
"Dot has?"
"He said, if only Leah knew Gid the way I know him, things like that. And he said he was weary of keeping it to himself any longer after these many years."
"Yeah, I know that to be true, the years he's stewed about it." She felt she ought to say one more thing.
"Mama's not so much in favor of Gid, though. Just so you know."
"You sure?"
"Mama prefers Jonas, seems to me."
Now she struggled to keep a straight face.
"She thinks your children will be mighty handsome if you marry into the Mast family."
"And why's that?"
"Jonas has a right fine nose. Good looking all around, he is." Mary Ruth sighed. I don't mean to say Smithy Gidd isn't handsome. He's just more rugged-looking, I guess you could say. Whereas Jonas is both handsome and strong. In body and mind, is that what you mean?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.